If you're looking for high production, great quality at the best value, you need to check out SANY America's largest wheel loader, the SW405K. I'm Nate Pietrosky with Newman Tractor. We've just received an SW405 SANY Wheel Loader, and with me I have Jordan from SANY America. He's going to show us a pre-shift inspection on this wheel loader.
So when we're looking at nomenclature on a SANY machine, the SW stands for SANY Wheel Loader, the 405 stands for the cubic yard bucket, and the K is the series we're in.
The 41,000 pound 405 is powered by a reliable Deutz engine, producing 965 foot-pounds of torque. Just over 40,000 pounds of breakout force. It's equipped with a 4-yard bucket with an 18 feet dump height. Top of the cab's 11.9. With our specs being done, I'm gonna turn this over to Jordan. He's gonna show a pre-shift.
So we're gonna do a walk around on this 405. So let's go start taking a look at it. So as we approach the machine, we're gonna look at the big picture, right? We're gonna check for if the mirrors are broken, if the lights are dangling off. The last thing you wanna be is getting on it and not noticing something and then you being held responsible for someone else's screw up. So again, we're paying attention to the big picture. Check the tires, make sure you don't see any visible leaks, anything crazy like that. When we do a pre-shift inspection, first things first, we need to make sure the machine's on flat level ground. We need to make sure that we start and finish in the same spot, because as we do that, we build a routine. So when things are out of the ordinary, it's gonna throw a little red flag saying, hey, we need to take a better visual inspection of that area. So guys, when I do my pre-shift inspection, I like to go counterclockwise. That way I can see everything, and by the time I get done, I'm back at my operator station. So what we're gonna first start looking at, this machine is actually equipped with a quick coupler. Some are pin-ons, as you guys know. We're gonna check our flag style pins. We're gonna check our keeper bolts. What we're checking here is that making sure that our keeper bolts are in place and that the flag style pin has not backed out. What can happen is that if you're not paying attention, your bucket pin can come out, and as you're lifting up to load, let's say a truck or a hopper, that pin can come out and your bucket's gonna get destroyed. So it's important that we're paying attention to that. As we come up, we're checking our boom, making sure we don't have any cracks. Cracks can be chip paint, water coming out of places it's not supposed to be, or a visible crack. Next, we're going to be checking our Z-bar linkage, making sure again the pins are in place, making sure we don't have any hydraulic leaks. We're checking the overall integrity of not only the Z-bar, but our boom. We're going to look at our front differential. You have two drain plugs, a fill and a drain plug. We want to make sure that there's no leaking. When a differential cools off, it tends to draw a vacuum. So any material that's built up around it or that has leaked out can possibly go back inside, destroying your front differential. We need to be making sure that this machine's getting greased every 10 hours or per shift. If we're hearing, it's too late and we need to really contact our supervisor and let them know that we got a problem. On our tilt cylinder, what we want to be checking for is our wiper seal and the bolts that hold that cylinder housing together. If we detect any leakage of hydraulic fluid, what can happen is that the dust collects on the cylinder, and as it goes back into the housing, it can actually contaminate your hydraulic tank and your filters and the system. We're only going to go over this once, but everything with this tire applies to all the other three. So first things first, we're checking for cuts, we're checking for cords, we're checking for string wire. So we're checking our lugs. So what we're looking for down here is we want 1.5 to 2 lugs on a hard ground. If we have 3 or 4 lugs, we should get a hold of our supervisor or whatever your site specific is to inflate tires. We do recommend that you run at least 10 pounds of PSI, more in the front than in the rear. And the reason is when I'm load and carry or I'm just traveling around with something in my bucket, the front tires tend to squat with that extra load. Some other things to check on the tire is our rim, making sure that our lock ring is in place, making sure that we don't have any lugs missing. Wheel loaders cannot be missing any lugs from the fact that it's putting stress on the ones around it, which can cause premature failure. The other thing we want to pay attention to is our valve stem cover. If we don't have a valve stem cover and we're cleaning out boxes or cleaning out settlement ponds, what can happen is material can get inside of that and start losing air, and then we have another problem. If you have any questions on tires, get with your supervisor or your local tire expert. Now that we're in our articulation point, we need to start looking at our flag style pins, our grease lines, our hydraulic hoses. We have our serial number placed here as well. We're gonna be checking out our center pins, making sure there's no slop, they're getting plenty of grease. Check our cab bolts, our windshield wiper reservoir is located right here, and our sight glass for our transmission. We have safety stickers here. When you do approach the machine, do not enter this location when there is someone in the operator's seat. The last thing you want to do is get hurt because someone else was running the machine. So now that we're at our steps, this is another spot to where we need to make sure when we're getting off the machine or back on that we're parked on flat level ground. Always maintain 3 points of contact getting up and off the machine. When we're doing our pre-shift inspection, it's important that we're taking a look, making sure that everything's intact. Right above me is the grease chart. It's going to show you where all the grease fittings are located and what the intervals are. To the right of that is our hydraulic sight glass. If you're not sure how to read the sight glass, consult your owner's manual. This hydraulic tank has right at 76.6 gallons of hydraulic fluid. On the safety portion of this is our boom lockout. We do have a footstep down here, tie down and lift point for transportation reasons, rear axle grease fittings. So with the air engine hood open, this is why it's going to be important for this machine to be parked on flat level ground. We need to pull engine oil dipstick. So how to do that properly? We need to pull it at least 2 times. The first time we're going to pull it out, we're going to wipe it off, put it back in. The second time we're going to actually check the true reading of that dipstick. The reason why we're doing this is that a diesel motor pulls a vacuum in the afternoon. After we're shut off for the day, it's actually going to try drawing air into it, but the engine's sealed, right? So it's bringing that oil level down. When we pull that dipstick out once, air's been introduced back in and it's gonna bring that oil level up. Always pull it twice. Some of the other things that are located in this area are our coolant sight glass, our engine oil filters, our water fuel separator, our DPF system. You're checking to make sure there's no trash buildup around it. They do get very hot. All the things that we need to be taking a overall broad view inspection of. When it comes to the air filter on this machine, it is the lungs of the machine, so it can affect your fuel economy and productivity. So we need to make sure that it's breathing properly. Make sure there's no dust around this when we open this up. This does have an airflow restriction reminder in the cab. So when you're running around and that light comes off, it's gonna tell you that, hey, I need to blow this out or it's time for a new replacement. Some companies don't want you to blow out air filters, but if yours is one of them, use low PSI of air, so 30 pounds of pressure less, or high volume. I have some companies that are using leaf blowers to blow out their air filter. Never take out the inner filter. If you ever notice there's dirt on that inner filter, the outer one's been destroyed and we need to go ahead and replace both. So when it comes to our battery box and battery disconnect, please always wear your proper PPE when dealing with the batteries. So as we open our battery box, you'll see the disconnect right here. This actually has a place where I can put a lockout tag out. So if I'm doing any maintenance, I can actually hook it right here. The other thing that we're looking for in the battery box is making sure that our terminals are in good working order. There's no debris, no buildup. This is a 24 volt system. So again, consult your supervisor, the OMM, or whatever your site specific is, if the battery's dead and we need to jump it. If you're uncomfortable with jumping a 24 volt system, get with someone who is. This machine has DEF. When we're done for the day or we're about to do service, please wait for that DEF purge to be done before we're disconnecting the master switch. What can happen if I shut the master switch off prematurely is I'll leave DEF in on my dosing lines. Not only will it corrode the lines, but it could freeze and bust them. So wait at least 2 minutes before we shut the master switch off. Now that we're at the back of the machine, let's look again at the big picture. Check underneath, make sure the counterweight bolts are there. Make sure there's no fluid underneath. Check the backup camera, check the lights. The grates are our first line of defense on keeping big particulates out of the radiator. This machine is equipped with a hydraulically reversing fan. Once we open up the rear door, there's not really any daily inspection checks. It is good to open it probably once or twice a week just to visually inspect the radiator fins. If we need to wash them out, let the machine dry overnight. If you need to put it right back to work, try to clean it out with air. As long as we're not bending the fins, we're gonna be okay. On this SANY wheel loader, we actually can separate the cooling packages with a latch, which is gonna give you better operation, better visibility to not only inspect, but to clean. So we're on the right side of the machine now, where our def is located. It's super important that we handle this with care, okay? So some key features on this 405, it does have a filter inside the tank. It is a 5.3 gallon def tank. One thing I would recommend as an operator is to never let this go below half a tank. If the light ever comes on, it has the potential of destroying the sensor because it's starting to pick up the crap out of the bottom of the tank. Some good little practices to keep good, fresh, clean def fluid. Keep it out of direct sunlight. If you only use half a jug, put it in something else that requires def or dispose of it properly. If we use bulk, keep a bucket of fresh water beside the nozzle. After we put it in the machine, take the nozzle, slosh it in the water, hang it upside down. That way the crystallization can't be built up inside the nozzle. Behind me, we have our 80 gallon fuel tank. We do have that water fuel separator on the side that will let you know and indicate there is water on the fuel, but it is important that we're topping this off at every end of the shift or when it gets parked for long periods of time. We're checking for exhaust leaks, we're checking for hose clamps, we're looking at anything that could potentially cause harm to the machine or yourself. Behind this door, we have our electrical. Would I open it every day? No, it's not necessary for your pre-shift inspection, but once a week, just to make sure there's no damage to the electrical. To the left of that is our fresh air filter for our cabin. Replace it when it's starting to get time. We're gonna come up here and look at our return to dig linkage plus our lower kickout linkage. It is electronic that is set to the monitor, but we need to make sure that the wiring harness is in good looking order. One more thing to check in this articulation point is our transmission fluid. It does have to be running. So after I've done all my checks of this machine, I've gone in the cab, done the proper checks, I've started it properly, come back out as the machine's warming, check my transmission fluid, climb up in the cab and you're ready to go. We're almost done with our pre-shift inspection. We're at our moneymaker. This one actually has two rows of hardware holding our reversible cutting edges together. It's really important that we maintain the tightness of our bolts and hardware, because what can happen is if we do not, our cutting edge will separate from the bucket, material can go in between and prematurely wear our bucket out. So we're done with our outside and shift inspection. We've checked the oil, the master disconnect is turned on. So let's climb up in the cab and go over everything before we start the machine. As soon as we sit down, the first thing you guys should be doing is putting your seatbelt on, right? Next is checking your mirrors, making sure that you have great visibility out. We're gonna check our surroundings, turn the key to the on position. What that does is allow the ECMs to communicate with each other to make sure that there's no faults within the electrical system. So we'll turn the key on, wait until the monitor pops up. Once the monitor pops up, you're gonna take that key and turn it clockwise till it starts the machine. Now that we got our machine running, let's check a couple other things before we start our operation. Let's check our fire extinguisher, make sure it's up to date and in good working order. Also, let's make sure our operation and maintenance manual is behind the seat. So on this SW405K, it is equipped with a front locking differential that is activated by a pedal on the floor, plus an open rear differential for better traction. As the operator, it's your responsibility to make sure you know what every button in this cab does. So we have our battery light that's letting you know the power is on to the machine. We have our caution light for our engine. The first two on our E-pillar are our turn signals. The ones underneath that are our working lights. Here is our front windshield wiper and the spray for our front windshield wiper. The next one below that is our rear window windshield wiper plus the spray to wash off the rear windshield wiper. Here's our F and R button. This button right here controls how we can shift the machine from forward, neutral, reverse. So when the light is over the R, we can actually control our forward, neutral, and reverse through our joystick. Right beside the F and R button is the hydraulic lockout. When the light is off, it is locked and my bucket controls do not work. But do remember, my steering cylinders still are activated. So when it's time to operate the machine, come to your hydraulic lockout, hit it, turn the light on, now my bucket controls will work. Below the hydraulic lockout and FNR is our hazard lights. Beside that, if equipped, is our beacon, our lower kickout. Both lights need to be activated for this feature to work. To activate return to dig, just press and make sure the light's on. Below those are our ride control. So when the light is on, ride control will turn on over 5 miles an hour. If you do not need ride control, press and hold it once and the light will cut off. Right beside ride control is our transmission neutralizer. When that light is on, the third pedal on the floor becomes a neutralizer. So what happens is I'm rolling up to a truck. If I have this on, it's more of a clutch. If this is off, you're riding through your brakes, which can lead to premature brake failure. So right here we have our transmission selector. So when it's in manual mode, I can control by the 1, 2, 3, 4 on the column how fast I want to go. When it is selected to auto, it will shift for me when it's detected that it needs to shift, and it will also downshift when necessary. Now that we're done with our E-pad or our buttons on the side of the machine, let's go through the monitor and make sure we understand what all the gauges are meant for and how we can read those properly. A brief overview of what everything means. So here we have our fuel. Right here at this little bar with the different colors is our depth gauge. Here's where it's showing us forward, neutral, reverse. Our coolant temperature for our engine. Here's the speed that we're running in kilometers. And of course our engine RPMs. Now, when you run this machine, something that you will see pop up is the def regen light. What that means for you is nothing. Continue running the machine as is. The more you run this machine and the hotter it gets, the less you'll see that regen light come on. Just continue running it as is. One setting in the monitor I do want to show you is in our fault codes. So if there is ever a fault code that pops up, we can go into vehicle fault or engine fault. I would encourage you guys to play around with the monitor and see the different functions that you can do. We're almost done with our in-cab pre-shift inspection. I would encourage you guys, if you don't know anything about ISO symbols, to carefully understand those. If there's a problem with the machine, being able to effectively communicate to your supervision what's going on is gonna help save downtime. On our bucket controls, of course, we have our up, our down, our dump, and our curl. So we have our third flow function here, our forward, neutral, and reverse, our kick down, so KD stands for kick down. What that means is if I'm in any other gear but first, I can hit this button once and it's gonna downshift the machine in order to penetrate a pile. And right here is our horn button. Your 405 is equipped with a quick coupler. I'm gonna walk you through how to disconnect it in a quick two-step process. First things first, we'll come over to our hydraulic lockout button. We're gonna hit it to where the light's on. Now, of course, our bucket controls work. So what we do need to do next, press and hold the hydraulic lockout button until it starts beeping. Once it starts beeping, we can reach up over here and we can pull down on the yellow and click it. That disengages our pins on our quick coupler. To put them back in, do it backwards. Click it down. Press once. I would encourage you for safety to rack the bucket back when you're doing this operation. Once you've locked those pins in, give it a little down pressure to verify that the pins have successfully locked. So now that we've started the machine, it's warmed up, the last thing we're gonna do in the cab before we start operating is we're gonna cycle the hydraulics. So what that means for you, curl the bucket back, raise it up about 3 or 4 times. We need to build the heat up in the hydraulic system. If you're in a cold climate area, do not start the machine up immediately and start lifting. What can happen, the hydraulic oil is so cold, the thickness can destroy the hydraulic filters. Let that machine warm up, then cycle your hydraulics. So guys, now that we're done our pre-shift inspection in the cab, go operate safely and we'll see you at the end of the shift. After we've parked and hit our parking brake, let that machine idle for a good 5 minutes. What this is gonna ensure that that turbo cools off. If we were gonna shut the machine off too quickly, it's gonna starve that turbo of oil and could cause premature failure on that turbo. Once we've climbed down from the machine, maintaining that 3 points of contact, if your site requires you to shut the master switch off, wait that 2 minutes. If not, you're good to go. Now that we're done with our pre-shift inspection, if you guys have any other questions,
come to any of our locations, get your butt in the seat. You can find them at newmantractor.com.